Good morning. I'll begin by repeating some topics that I was discussing in the earlier lecture, and I'll try to take it further. Because I think when it was towards the end of the lecture, I tried to rush up some topics. So this diagram, which is an important diagram, describes what is a von Neumann architecture. And I mentioned that most of the computers that are around us are basically built around this architecture, no matter whether it's a laptop or up to a supercomputer. So the CPU, which has a star in MATLAB, that means it's possibly a multiprocessor or a multi-core CPU, keeps running instructions. The thread of execution represents continuous execution of instructions. So what does the CPU do? We already discussed that. The CPU fetches an instruction given by the location stored in the program counter, executes it. As a part of execution, it may change the program counter. It does actually change the program counter. It may increment it or it may change it to another location. Then all it does is repeats the same thing. So there is a continuous movement of instruction and data between the RAM and the CPU. And RAM is basically a kind of static device which keeps storing data. That it, all it can do is send some data to the CPU. That's it. The I/O devices, the star M here means multiple I/O devices, are connected over a bus to the CPU, and normally they talk to the CPU or using interrupts by transferring some data by making some I/O request. Some of the I/O devices can also talk to the memory directly using the DMA. You have all studied these concepts in your course on microprocessor. You have studied interrupts, you have studied DMA, you have also studied the machine instructions in your course on microprocessor. Now I mentioned that most of the time the CPU is transferring data between itself and main memory. That is what happens most of the time. Normally there is no data transfer between CPU hard disk, CPU keyboard, CPU mouse, etc. The data from I/O devices has to go to the RAM, fine, and CPU will access the data from the RAM. So the most important slide I mentioned was this, that all that the CPU does from the moment it is turned on until it is turned off is this. It will fetch instructions from RAM and then decode and execute those instructions. The location of the instruction was given by program counter. While executing an instruction, it may fetch more data from the RAM. As a result of number two, it will actually change the program counter. Normally it will increment it by 4 and then it will repeat the same thing. So it's an infinite loop. Your CPU is an infinite loop. It keeps doing the same thing again and again. So the real task in front of us is to understand how is all that magic happening that we are seeing right now in front of us. How is it that using this very simple hardware mechanism, we are able to make a desktop operating system work or any other operating system work, and we are able to do all these wonderful things. Well, obvious questions that come to mind are, what is the initial value of program counter? Who put in this value in the program counter? And what is there, at that location given by the program counter? So throughout this course, you need to keep asking yourself the question, what is running on the processor? If you are able to visualize, what is happening on the processor, then I can say that you are able to correlate many concepts in operating system with the hardware features, and you are able to build a bridge between hardware and the software world. Now, I introduce certain concepts to you. I will revise those concepts once again. So, OS kernel, some people call this as the OS, but some people don't call this as OS. So the word OS is a confusing word. I will mention it once again. So OS kernel is the code that is actually loaded and given the control of the entire system when the computer boots. It is the code which actually takes control of the hardware. How does it take control of hardware? We will see it later, all right? But this is the code which controls everything. It is the code which creates an environment for applications to execute, and it controls access to hardware. Fine. So this is the code which controls everything. Our course is about the OS kernel actually. Our course is not about the other parts of OS. it is about the OS kernel. Everything which is not OS kernel is applications. So whatever you see on your computer right now, LibreOffice, Firefox, Google Chrome, Terminal, PI, Edit, gedit, compiler, they're all applications. Everything, the graphical user interface on Unix, Linux is application. Among the applications, there are two types of applications. One is system programs. Now, why are they called system programs? They are called system programs because they depend very heavily on the kernel and the processor. So the code of these applications is written keeping in mind a particular processor and a particular kernel. That is why they are called system programs. For example, compiler. A compiler has to generate machine code for a target processor, and a compiler has to execute on a particular operating system. So the code of compiler is heavily dependent on the system, right? Linker, loader, your C library, they are, I'll consider them to be system programs or system libraries. Then there are other programs. For example, the terminal, the Firefox, the VLC, their code is normally not dependent on the kernel and processor. So basically they go through a compiler, all right? And the compiler takes care of everything. So the compiler will compile the source code and give you machine code for a particular kernel and processor. But while writing the code, you are not worried about for which processor you are writing the code, for which OS you are writing the code. So most of the programs, for example, you wrote in your data structures course, you never had to worry about for which processor you are writing it and for which OS you are writing it. Normally they would run on any OS and any processor. So those are, we'll say, other applications. Now let us revisit the boot order. I kind of rushed it up, so I will go through it again slowly. So once again, the CPU. I have to turn the power button on my laptop and the CPU is powered on. Now what is the CPU going to do? It is going to fetch an instruction, but from where, right? So there is a predefined value in the program counter. That value was determined by your motherboard manufacturer, the CPU manufacturer. So the question, which code does the CPU run initially and in which order? So the first code it runs is called BIOS, the basic input output system. The core of the BIOS is actually hardwired into a memory called ROM, read-only memory, on the motherboard. This is done by the motherboard manufacturer. And the CPU will now run it automatically when it is turned on. Why? Because this code is located at the address, which is the default value in the program counter. Default value of program counter is well documented by the processor manufacturers in their manuals. So as a motherboard manufacturer, you would know at which address should you put your BIOS code. So, you know, it all fits together very well. And you turn on the computer, it starts running the BIOS. For example, you have these two screens in front of you. The first screen, American Megatron. This was one of the popular BIOSes actually. And this company used to manufacture motherboards and BIOS both. And lot of other companies like Asus and HP and Dell, they would, you know, buy it from American Megatrends. So that is how you used to see this kind of screen. The BIOS would basically do some interaction with the I/O devices. It will turn them on. It will do the initial configuration of the hardware devices so that they are ready to interact. That is why it is called a basic input output system. Okay. So we will learn sometimes later in this course that the BIOS had capability of handling interrupts and so on. But we'll see that later. So the BIOS code runs and it will also show you this thing like press F1 to go to setup, press F2 to do something, press F9 to do the boot menu and so on. So now if you press the key, the BIOS code will handle that key and it will show you maybe the menu that you see on the right side here, you know, a blue kind of screen where you could do some configuration with your hard disk and so on. So that was BIOS. Now, the BIOS, after, you know, you don't do anything, BIOS will run automatically. Automatically, what it will do? It will try to locate another program called bootloader. Where will it try to locate the bootloader code? So, BIOS is a input-output system. So, it will detect that you have a hard disk, you have a pen drive attached, you may be having network attached. So, it will figure it out. It will figure out that you have these I/O devices connected. And depending on something called as a boot order, which is also a configuration of the BIOS. So, if your boot order says that first pen drive, then hard disk, then CD, what it will do, it will try to see on the pen drive first that, hey, does the pen drive have a code called bootloader? If the pen drive has a code called bootloader, which is normally a code in the sector 0 of either CD or hard disk or pen drive, it will read that sector and load it into the memory and then just jump to it. So the last line of instruction in BIOS is a jump instruction after loading the code of bootloader, and it will jump to the bootloader code. So now BIOS is over because you jumped out of BIOS code, you jumped into the bootloader code. So now the bootloader will start running. So the next thing which comes is a bootloader, and these are diagrams of some bootloaders, different type of bootloaders. The first black color diagram is the most popular Linux bootloader called Grub. This is a bootloader shown by which is normally exist on a Windows disk, and this is a different type of a bootloader. So bootloader was there, this code was there on your pen drive or on your hard disk or CD or something like that. The question is, who put that code there? It was put in there while creating the bootable pen drive or while creating the CD or when you were installing OS on your hard disk. That time the code was put into the boot sector 0 of the particular device. So now that code is in the RAM, that code is executing. What does this code do? This code again scans your hard disk and pen drive and so on, and also its own configuration files, and it finds all the OS's that are installed on your hard disk. And it will show you the options to boot. So that is what you see, you know, whether you want to boot this Ubuntu, that Ubuntu, or Windows and so on. Now, as an end user, you choose one and you press enter. And now the bootloader will actually copy the code of the OS into RAM, and then it will jump to that code. Now, when we see the source code of the x86 operating system, we will see all of this, you know, in actual source code. We will see the code of the bootloader, we will see how the OS gets loaded, and so on. Before we go further, I think I am not sharing my entire screen, so you may not be able to see my terminal. So let me share my entire screen first. Yeah. Let me share the entire screen. It's quite slow with WebEx. Maybe my network is slow. Okay, good. So now I am sharing my entire screen. I hope it is visible. So I am on the terminal now. I hope you can see my terminal. Now, on your Linux, if you go to /boot, then this file is the file which is your Linux kernel. Okay, you can see I have two of them, 5.11.0-11-43. So these are two different Linux kernel code files corresponding to two different versions of Linux kernel. So yeah, this is the Linux kernel code. Fine, this is not an executable file. This is the file that is picked up by your bootloader. So when you boot from Ubuntu, this file will be picked up from your hard disk and put into the RAM, and that OS code will run then. Fine. Now you are off from the bootloader world, and now you are into the OS world. The code of OS will run now. Remember, your CPU is still doing the dumb job of fetch, decode, execute. Okay. It is we, the system designers, who have intelligently made it do different things. First, made it run BIOS, then made it run the bootloader. Now we are making it run the OS. Now, the OS runs, and the when I say OS here, remember, throughout this course, when we say OS, we mean the kernel. Like, although the word OS should be used in a different context, but when we say OS, we mean the kernel. So now the OS, what does it do? It does some magic. We will learn that magic. It takes control of the hardware. Fine. It does something which will not allow later on applications to control hardware. The OS will control hardware. It will create an environment for applications to run. What it also does is it loads some initial application. That application is called init on Linux and Unix. It will load that application also into RAM and then pass control to the init application. Fine. Now, if you see this diagram says error file slash weblin is not found. So this you will see when the bootloader could not load the Linux kernel. Now, this step number three, this step number three is something which you actually don't see happening, because it happens in such a small fraction of a second that you normally don't get to see it. What I'll try to do, I hope you are able to see my virtual box screen. Can you see my virtual box screen, students? Can somebody say yes?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So what I'm going to do, I have a Ubuntu 2004 virtual machine, and I'm just going to start it, right? And I'm going to speak fast because this thing is going to run fast. All right. So just pay attention to what I'm saying. I press start, and BIOS is running. BIOS is running now. Now bootloader is running. Now bootloader has a timer, you know, to automatically boot the default Ubuntu. It is ticking down 2, 1, 0. Linux is loading. Okay, Linux loading is over. Now applications are running. This is application world. We are into application world now. Loading of Linux happened in a very, very small fraction of a second, and it started running. Its job was done. What you see right now are all applications. This is application world. All right. So I just described you the sequence. What you see here are applications. All right. So I will try to, I don't know like how to show you, you know. So what happens when you press enter on the grub menu, for a very small fraction of second, there is a message displayed, loading VM Linux. And that is the time when the Linux kernel is getting loaded. Now it happens so fast that we are not able to observe it actually. Fine. So let me try to do this bad thing, resetting. This you should not do. BIOS, bootloader. Now I am pressing enter. I don't know whether we can see it now. No, it doesn't show actually. So it's over. Loading Linux is over. The first message you saw here, recovering journal, was application message. It was not kernel message. So fine. So I just described with the boot order. It happened so fast. So again, here are the diagrams. This, which you see normally, is an application executing. This is mostly an init code or some variant of init code running. The login screen is another program that is running. And when you come here, you are all into the world of applications executing. Fine. Now, I took this screenshot because precisely it shows that the kernel was not found. So you are stuck with the bootloader. The bootloader is saying, yeah, I can't find the kernel. All right. Any questions about the boot process? I'll give you a minute to think about it and ask your questions. We are going to see more details of the boot process later. Okay, we are going to see the actual code. We are going to see the smaller nitty-gritties of the x86 processor, which we need to know in order to understand how a bootloader works, how does it load the OS. We need to learn something about memory management of x86, because the loading has to happen in memory, right? So we need to know how the CPU talks to the memory, the particular memory architecture supported by x86. Because if you want to load the OS in memory, you have to know something about hardware features of x86. So we will learn those and we will see in more detail how does it work, right? But as of now, is the broad picture becoming clear to you? Kunal has a question that why does it say kernel is not found sometimes even when there is OS? So there is something wrong with the configuration of your bootloader. Your bootloader was told that the kernel file will be in a particular location on the hard disk, but for whatever reason it is not there. So your bootloader is not configured properly to locate the OS. Remember, the bootloader is not normally the bootloader is not intelligent enough to scan the hard disk and find the OS. No, it doesn't do like that. What happens is when the bootloader is installed, at that time the OSs are searched and installed. So for example, the simple command that you can run on your Ubuntu. Remember, I'm doing it on my host. Okay. Normally don't do it on host. So if you say update grub, grub is the name of the bootloader program. Update grub is a program on my Ubuntu which will basically update the bootloader. So if I run this, the update grub program is actually one which is scanning my disk, and see, it is saying, hey, I found this kernel 11.0.43. I found this kernel. It says, hey, I also found Windows. Alright, and fine, it also says UEFI firmware settings. We will learn about UEFI later. So what it did, it actually created the menu that I see at the time of booting my system. Alright, and it updated my bootloader. Now if it did the job properly, normally I won't see the problem you are mentioning. But if this program for whatever reason did not do its job properly and so on, I will have problems while booting my system. I hope it helps you, Kunal. Okay, because we are doing this, let me show you something more. Once again, I'm turning on my Ubuntu 2004 and I'm on the bootloader, so I just press the key to disable the timer. Now see here, I am on a particular option and I'll press E, and what I see here is the configuration option of my bootloader. So actually I can change things. So for example, see here, this is where the file it is supposed to locate is mentioned. So I can actually change it. You know, I can say this and this, and if I now say boot by pressing some key and F10, then it will try to load that file, which may not exist. Yeah, right? I just did some random changes here. So yeah, so see now, it says, bootloader says that this file is not found. Now you need to load the kernel first. So the kernel loading has failed, right? So I think I reproduced the problem which you mentioned by doing something nasty, right? Is it okay, Kunal? Kunal, is it okay?
Yes, actually,
I can't hear you, Kunal. Kunal, I am not able to hear you.
Sir, I...
Let me stop my video. Kunal, can you repeat?
Sir, I was unable to chat in chat. I couldn't.
All right, fine, Kunal. All right. Any other questions? Yeah, no problem. Other questions? Other people, feel free to ask your questions about the boot process.
Sir, what do we mean by OS creates environment to run the application?
Good question. So basically, the OS code is now there in the RAM, and the OS creates its own API. We should not call it API, but yeah, the term does suit here also. So basically, the OS exports certain functions called as system calls. System calls are the interface given by the OS for applications to interact with the hardware. Now, every application wants to, not every, but most applications want to interact with hardware. For example, you want to do scanf printf in your code. That is interacting with the hardware. So scanf printf basically end up using the operating system provided functions, system calls, to do the reading and writing from keyboard and screen. That is what I mean as one example of environment created by OS. So largely it is related to making available the system calls. We will see more about it. Okay, the whole purpose of this course is to learn what is the environment created by the OS. So we will see more about it. But I hope I answered your question partially.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. One more question. In which programming language the BIOS and bootloader code are written?
So the bootloader code is grub on Linux, and it's very easy to actually get it. Do I have grub here? No. So apt. Sorry, what is apt get? So sorry, why I'm forgetting this? Yeah. Oh no, I don't have it. So I think by running this command, you can get the source code of grub. And what it is saying is, I don't have the deb src in my sources.list. So I will open this file, etc/apt/sources.list. And what I have done is, I have actually commented all these. So I should not, I will uncomment this. So I can fetch the source code also directly using the apt. All right. Now I need to run apt update first. And this is big problem with UEP network today. Yeah, this is failing because the network is giving lot of problems. But I think, yeah, now it has worked. So now, okay, there is no package called grub, maybe grub2. Yeah, package is called grub2. So this is the source code of grub that I am downloading now. This is the grub2 code. You can verify, I think this is in C. Unidata.c. So this is C code. This is C code. The grub bootloader is in C. The BIOS code is normally also written in C. But I don't have the BIOS code with me. But it could be written in assembly also directly. Normally they write all the code in C, and they use appropriate type of compilers or code converters to convert it into the appropriate type of machine language. Because see, grub is not a, the machine code of grub is not like the machine code of your a.out or whatever executable files you normally create by saying cc something dot c minus or something. So that executable code is slightly different from the executable code of grub. So even if you write it in C, you cannot simply use a gcc command to create the code of the bootloader. So the way it is compiled is different, but it could be written in C by mixing assembly language with C. Did I answer your question?
Yes, sir. So don't we need to initiate the compiler first to compile this code and convert into executable file to
run
the
BIOS? What do you mean by initiating compiler?
Means at the last, the system, the applications are loaded, no, but for this code to run, we will need a compiler to compile it and convert to executable files.
Sorry, sorry, your voice broke. I could not hear you. Can you repeat what you said?
Yes, sir. In the boot order, first we run the BIOS program. But to run, we will need to convert it to executable file, the C code to executable.
No, not at all. It is already in executable format. The BIOS code is machine code. When it exists in the ROM, it exists as a machine code. When I said it was written in C, it was written on some another computer by somebody in C. On that another computer, they used some different type of compiler to convert into machine code. Then they use some different type of tools to actually take that machine code and put it into the ROM. When it comes on your computer, it comes only as machine code in the ROM. All right, understand one thing. Compiler is normally used to compile applications on a particular OS and hardware. Compiler is not used for everything like the way you have used so far. There are compilers like GCC are highly flexible. They can be used for different purposes. But then yes, the compiler can actually be put to different uses, not to compile an application only. There is a different thing needed to be done when you compile a library. There is a different thing need to be done when you compile an OS kernel. There's a different thing to be needed when you compile a compiler using a compiler. The job of compiler is not the same in all these cases. The kind of machine code it generates is not the same in all these cases. Does it help or it makes you more confused?
Yes, sir, I understood.
देखो आपका लाइफ का एक्सपीरियंस ये रहा है अभी तक दैट यू राइट अ प्रोग्राम यू कंपाइल एंड देन यू रन इट. नो दैट इज नॉट हाउ यू डू इट विद द बायोस कोड एंड द बूट लोडर कोड. सो द बूट लोडर कोड as I showed you now, when you do the update grub is a command which will actually play with your bootloader code as a machine code. There is another command called install grub. Fine. This install grub will actually copy the bootloader code into the sector zero of your hard disk. So don't think that see, compiler doesn't run programs. Make it clear to yourself. Compiler doesn't run programs. Compiler only creates a machine code file. That's it. An executing program is something in the RAM. While what compiler does is it just creates a file on the hard disk. That's it. Compiler doesn't run programs. Please say more. I want to clear all your doubts. So don't hesitate. If I've confused you more, ask more questions. If there's anything even slightly unclear, ask me. Don't imagine things in your head, okay? Try to get the clarity. Don't assume something unnecessarily.
So already the executable code is there and it is executed in the RAM itself, in the boot order, while loading the
Correct.
BIOS first.
Correct. When you
Okay.
purchase your computer, the ROM was having machine code of BIOS in the ROM, and when you turn it on, it runs. Normally, when you install something on your computer, the bootloader also gets installed as a machine code, and then the BIOS passes on to that machine code of the bootloader. When the bootloader loads your OS exists as machine code. So, this file, VM Linux, is nothing but machine code file. All right. Okay. Permission denied. So, sudo. So, this is a machine code, okay, of your Linux kernel. And this was loaded as machine code. It started running as machine code. Right? Does it help you now?
Yes, sir. Understood now.
So good you are asking these questions because sometimes it is difficult for me to understand where the gap is.
sir, what are fallback images?
Can you say that again? What are which images?
Fallback images found in slash boot sometimes, like not on all the distributions, but few distribution has the name slash fallback image.
So I don't understand it because which distribution has the fallback image?
So Arch-based distribution has a kernel name dash fallback dot image files along with the normal files you mentioned.
I don't know, but looking at the name, I can do some guesswork. So maybe if you know normally, so for example, there are people who keep playing with their kernel and they compile a new kernel and they install a new kernel and they try to boot using the new kernel. And now, if it doesn't work because you made some nasty modifications to the kernel and it doesn't work, so the system will try to boot using the fallback kernel, kernel which you supposedly think it works. So I think it should be something like that. So for example, here I have two kernels, right? 11 and 41 and 43. Now, what I can really do is here I have a source code of Linux 5.5 and I can actually make some changes to it. For example, I can. So remember, this is a source code of kernel. Okay, this is just the source code of the kernel. I go here, let us say, I open this reboot.c and I say this is two, fine, for whatever reason. And then I quit this. Now I need to do what? I have to compile this kernel. When I compile this kernel will become available as a vmlinux file. Now I need to take the vmlinux file, put it into slash boot. Then I need to tell my bootloader, hey, there is another kernel available. Then I need to reboot my system with the new kernel. But then it may not work, right? Because I made some bad modifications. So then I need to have a kernel which works. So normally you will see Grub will show you the older versions of Linux kernel also. So you can always boot from the older version. Just like here, it is already running. So maybe I will reset this once again. Yeah. And where is it? Yeah. So here, no, I don't have any older Ubuntu here. But normally you will notice that you have more options here, the older versions also. So that means you can boot from the older kernel also. Booting from older kernel only means the kernel is different. Rest of the things remain the same. Applications remain the same. You won't notice any difference in the behavior normally. Yeah, more questions. More questions.
Sir, in the computer organization course, Sawan sir mentioned that while booting the system, the processor runs in the real mode. Can you explain that?
Correct. So I'll explain it later. Okay. When we start reading the x86 code, I will explain you the real mode once again. Basically, the mode exists because x86 historically developed as 80286, 386, 486, 586, then this whole i3, i5, i7 series, and so on. With every new processor, they kept adding features. But they also said, we will maintain all the features we had given you earlier. So to maintain compatibility with the old versions of the processor, in the newer versions, they have to introduce two modes. All right. Now, what does it exactly mean? Let's hold on. Okay. We will see. Fine, let me go ahead now. This. Fine, so same slide again. Now, let me tell you something about a complete computer system, a desktop system, which is not the actually subject matter of our course. The subject matter of our course is the kernel. But how is a modern day desktop system built on top of a hardware? So, the layering, okay, and most of the things in computer science are layering. So, there is hardware. and this is bare bones hardware, motherboard, keyboard, mouse, RAM, processor. The operating system is a layer on top of it, fine. And the other programs, applications are a layer on top of the OS. Now, and the end users actually interact with the programs, application programs. We never interact with the kernel directly. We always interact with the compiler or a graphical user interface. The most important thing that should have been here is a GUI. The graphical user interface on Unix, Linux is also an application. So we interact with the applications, and the applications in turn interact with the operating system and the hardware. So this diagram is not very correct. It doesn't show the applications dealing with the hardware, but yeah, applications can deal with hardware also. But mostly, yeah, there is this kind of a layering which is there. So basically, the layering means that hardware will give you features which OS will use to do its job, and OS will give you system calls which the applications can call to get some job done by the OS, and applications will give you features which we end users use, for example, LibreOffice. I can click here, there, file menu, edit menu, etc. on LibreOffice and use LibreOffice. So there is a layering, okay? The computer system is built using layering. Now, question is, what constitutes an OS? Now, most typically, in my opinion, okay, an OS is kernel plus system programs, that is the C library, the compiler, the linker, loader, terminal, something called a shell, and a user interface, maybe command line or graphical interface, and other applications. Now, whether to include other applications in OS is also a matter of debate. But some people call the kernel itself as OS, and even course itself is named OS, but it means kernel. So there is this confusion about the word operating system. So although popularly I do believe that the kernel plus other system programs should be called OS, whenever I say normally OS in this course, I mean the kernel. So there is an often debated question in the Linux world, and the free software people, the Mukta software people say that Linux should not be called Linux, it should be called GNU Linux. Why? Because Linux will not work if we do not have the system programs given by GNU, which is correct actually, that if you do not have the C library and the GCC compiler and the other C, the other tools provided by GNU, then the Linux kernel will not work. So the kernel is practically useless without all the supporting environment. So we say that, hey, don't call it Linux, you call it GNU Linux. Linux is just a kernel, okay? What people say is Linux is just a kernel. What you see right now in front of you as Ubuntu or a Fedora or Arch Linux is not actually Linux, it is Linux plus so many other things. Okay, Linux is the name of the kernel. Now, let me tell you a problem, the bootstrap problem. Why I'm telling you this problem is because this problem is actually there everywhere in the operating system dictionary of problems. So the question, okay, let's take an example. How do you compile your programs? And you all know the answer. So I use a compiler, right? Obviously, I use a compiler to compile my program. But if I ask you the question, how do you compile a compiler? Well, I wrote a compiler in C, how do I compile that compiler? So the answer to that is using the older version of the compiler. So use the older version of the compiler, and see, when you use the older version of compiler, you actually use the executable code of the older version of the compiler. So yes, it will give you the new compiler. Then the question comes, how was the older version of the compiler compiled? So the answer is even older version of the compiler. So you can now take it, you know, backwards, and you can ask the question, how was the first version of the compiler compiled? Because then there was no older version of the compiler. So now the bootstrap problem arises, and the answer is don't compile, assemble it. So there might have existed an assembler, and I know that you know what an assembler is. You studied the concept of an assembler in microprocessors. So an assembler, you know, you write code in assembly language and use a program called assembler to assemble the assembly language code, convert it into machine code. So the first version of the compiler was not compiled, it was assembled. But then the question comes, where did the assembler come from? So one can say using older version of the assembler, but you can now take it back. You know, how to assemble the first version of the assembler? So the answer to that is don't assemble, do it by hand. That means manually write it in the machine code. So the first version of assembler was written in machine code by the end programmer. Fine. The bootstrap problem exists in many varieties. So for example, how to boot the computer? Hey, I want to run my program on the hardware I have bought. How do I run my program? So then they say, hey, you need a OS to do that. How do I run my OS? They say, yeah, you need a bootloader to load the OS. How do I load the bootloader? Hey, you need a BIOS to do that. How do you load the run the BIOS? They say, hey, it has to be hardwired. It has to be hardwired. So yes, so there is a bootstrapping happening that the BIOS runs bootloader, bootloader runs OS, OS allows applications to run and so on. But the BIOS problem has to be solved in hardware. The BIOS problem is indeed solved in hardware. Rest of the problems are solved in software world. BIOS to bootloader, bootloader to OS, they're all software. But the very problem of running the BIOS itself is solved in hardware. So in your daily life experience, you are actually using solutions to many pre-solved bootstrap problems. So for example, you ask actually the right question. You know, when you said, wo BIOS ko compile karke kaise run karte hain, bola, nahin, 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 wahan wo sab nahin hota hai. Wo already wahan machine code pada hai BIOS ka. So you were trying to solve a bootstrap problem in your mind without realizing, no, the bootstrap problem can't apply there. You know, there has to be a machine code of the BIOS already present in the ROM. Fine. So, this was the basic description of bootstrap problem. Your computer boots using a solution to the bootstrap problem. Now, how is a Debian or Ubuntu build? Well, what you have in front of you is a complete functional usable desktop computer system. Now, a Debian is something like this. A Debian is obviously a kernel. You need a kernel, right? Because without a kernel, no application can run. So kernel plus system programs plus some applications that these people liked, the Debian people liked. Because there are crores of applications in the world. Like for example, one can ask, do I get Dev program, the computer program called Dev on Debian? And the answer is no. Why? Because the Debian people didn't want it to be on Debian. Simple. So that is why selected applications, not all possible applications in the world. Like you don't get NoSQL database pre-installed on Debian. You have to install it later on. So they don't give it you by default. Now, system programs, as I mentioned, there are again two types of them, you know, like unavailable system program. Why unavailable? Because without them, the kernel will not work. Like the C library compiler, some libraries like the terminals, which make the terminal work, the mathematics work, and something called as linker loader. And even among applications, like if you want it to be minimally usable, you would nowadays include a graphical user interface, browser, etc. And then you may optionally include some other applications like LibreOffice and Gedit and PDF Viewer and VLC, etc. etc. That is the choice. So all these Linuxes, they basically differ in their choices. Debian, Fedora, Mint, Arch Linux. So there are different people who do these different Linuxes. They differ in many things, like even in the choice of the kernel. Somebody may say, yeah, I want to stick to kernel version 5.11 because of some reason. Some Linux wala will say, then I want to go to the latest kernel. And the moment you go to latest kernel, all your other choices can also change. So the magic of making a Debian or Ubuntu lies in taking the source code from different places, literally thousands of places, because there are thousands of applications and thousands of libraries. So you take source code from those thousands of different places, you compile all of them. How do you compile all of them? Obviously, there is a bootstrap problem involved here. Because you're trying to make a functional system which will allow people to compile code, but how do you make that system itself? You will have to do it on some other system. The bootstrap problem, once again. Right? So if I want to build my own Linux, I will use my Ubuntu desktop, which is there with me right now. You know, bootstrap problem. So you compile the different source code. The jadu lies in making it work. You take thousands of different pieces of software, all of them develop them independently. You make them work together to make a usable system. That is the jadu that the Debian people do. So Debian people do all of this. If you want to become a Debian developer, your basic job is to do this. Right? To make a software work with the rest of the software. For example, this. No, your job is something like this. GitLab. Now you all know GitLab, right? But GitLab is a easily available application. But I can't install GitLab because Ubuntu people have not chosen GitLab to be a readily integrated software in the Ubuntu system. But it is there in Debian actually. In Debian, you can do apt install GitLab. And one of my friends, Praveen, he's a Debian developer. He did it. He packaged GitLab so that it works with rest of the things in Debian. All right. So that is the job these people do. They don't write kernel. Okay. They don't write terminal. They don't write VI. They don't write libraries. They make them work together. That is what the Debian people do. Ubuntu people simply copy Debian and make some modifications. Okay. So that is Ubuntu. Fine. This is the formula, maybe not correct. Maybe a little bit here and there. But Ubuntu is largely Debian plus some modifications. Okay. So the Debian people do the real job. So Debian is the wonderful Linux, the mother of most Linuxes. Now there is an interesting project called Linux from Scratch project. So earlier I used to give this project as a project in this course. And now I am not giving you this as a course project. Okay. But if you are really interested, you can try this. This project makes you build a Linux system on bare hardware by manually bringing all software components together. Now, obviously, so many bootstrap problems will have to be solved to do this. So, first question is, what will you do first? You know, I gave you hardware and I want you to build a complete usable system bit by bit. Fine. So, how will you do it? Fine. You have to begin with the partitioning first. You have to... What is the first software you will take on it? How will you take it there? Right? So the Linux from Scratch project actually helps you learn how this is done. This is not part of our course. Okay, our course is about the kernel. Alright, we learn the kernel. We do learn something about the system programs also, which make the kernel work properly. Kernel becomes usable to end users. Linux from Scratch or Debian is not part of our course. Our course is largely about the kernel. Okay, so I hope I made the scope clear. Questions about this. There is a question already in the chat. In some operating systems, we have to install grub manually. Right. Maybe those operating system and their installer programs were not mature enough to do the job of bootloader properly. So you may have to do it manually, right? There's a question, so without grub, can we boot into OS? Yes, possible. If you have a single boot OS, if you have a system where there's only one OS, it is possible that the BIOS simply locates the OS itself in the place of the bootloader and passes on the control to the OS. Normally it doesn't happen nowadays because OS is big code, while the bootloader is a small code. Bootloader resides in sector 0, one sector of your hard disk or pen drive or something. So bootloader is a small thing, but if you had a very small OS which can fit in sector 0, the BIOS could directly go to the OS. Yeah, it was possible. Nowadays, it doesn't happen because all OSs are so big that you need a bootloader code which will load the entire OS. So that would stop. There's a question by Vishwesh. While booting Ubuntu on my machine, 60% of time Ubuntu boots without any problems, but 40% times I get error, command failed error, you need to load the kernel first. Now that is a very weird problem, Vishwesh, I can't comment on it. I mean, it works 60 times and doesn't work 40 times, so that is very unlike software. Software works very deterministically, right? So I can't comment on your problem. It will need more observation and more information to say why it is like that.
But sir, it's happening that way. Sometimes I do get the error that you need to load the kernel first. But sometimes when I on the machine, it loads without any problems.
Yeah, so all I can do is I can make some speculative guess. Right, I can't give you a perfect answer to this because this is a weird, bizarre problem. So if I make a comment, that will confuse people more. It may be something more related to the UUID that is specified as the identification of the hard disk in the grub configuration file, and maybe the BIOS or UEFI on your computer is playing with the UUID of your hard disk for whatever weird reason. Maybe the connector of the hard disk itself is loose. Now that is a very extremely rare phenomenon, right? That the connector is loose and the hard disk is simply getting connected. All these things happen actually. The worst things are also possible, but I can't say anything for sure why it is happening. Mostly it works very deterministically. No? Fine. Now I'll just conclude. Okay, I have a few more slides. Now, more about the CPU. Now, CPUs are actually manufactured keeping desirable OS features in mind. Yes, the CPU manufacturers always think about the OSs that are going to run. And the purpose of this course is to learn in more detail. So, for example, one example, you don't have to understand it now. There is something called as two modes of operation in a CPU. They are part of the CPU design to allow for a multi-user, multitasking OS to run on it. So a purpose of our course is to learn why certain CPU features are there and their relationship with the OS. Further, now the topics that you need to revise are interrupts, interrupt handling, x86 instructions, the assembler directives, how to use assembler and all, C programming, very, very importantly, pointers and function pointers and all, and then GCC compilation options. So what I'm going to do is, tomorrow you will have a quiz on Moodle. That is a mandatory quiz for everyone to attempt, not part of your evaluation. But all of you need to score 100% in the quiz in order to attempt any further assignments or quizzes. I will not share the answers of the quiz with you. You will get infinite number of attempts, but you need to score 100% in that quiz. So that is a prerequisite quiz. Okay, and that will be based on what you see right now in front of you on x86c, GCC, interrupts and so on. So basically all the concepts from some concepts, not all, from microprocessor and CPU, because these courses were largely focused on how does a processor work internally. What we are interested in right now is what does a processor give to us as a OS programmer. Fine, so you will have a quiz coming up. Very small, very few concepts now, miscellaneous concept. One, we often, you know, talk about multiprocessor systems, and there is a typical type of multiprocessor system called symmetric multiprocessor system. There are basically, so that means there can be a symmetric multiprocessor system also, but we only focus on SMP in our code. What does the SMP mean? So it's a multiprocessor. So there are a lot of processors together on one motherboard. But what does the symmetric mean? Symmetric means that there is a CPU 0, 1, 2 and maybe more, but they have access to the same shared memory. So the access to the memory is symmetric, fine, in that sense. All right. So the memory is shared. All of them access the same memory. They have their own local cache, but remember the cache is always handled in the processor. So we OS programmers don't deal with the cache. Now people say dual core, quad core, etc. All it means is that it's a single CPU chip having something called as a core, and the core actually appears as if it was a different CPU. again, we don't worry much about whether the two CPUs that I see are from a dual core or two chips. We don't worry about it. For us, there are two processors. That's it. So that was about it. And now, to finally conclude, the very important question to keep remembering is who does what? What is done by hardware? What is done by OS? What is done by compiler? What is done by linker, loader, and end human user? Answering this particular question is key to understanding how the entire computer system works. So there is a very intelligent thing happening here. There is no magic, absolutely no magic. Magic doesn't exist. There is a very intelligent The OS kernel is a major workhorse. The OS kernel does a major work out of the whole work. But still, the other people have to do work. Compiler has to do particular thing. Linker loader have to do particular thing. And hardware has to do particular things. And the OS does a lot of things. But they all fit together to make a system work. So what does each of them do? How do they fit together? That is the magic. You know, if I want to use the word magic. We are going to learn that. Fine. As of now, we stop. It's time. I'll see you later. I'll let you know whether I have an extra class this week. Okay, we'll stop now.